Recently gave grand rounds at my institution on social media and medicine, and I got a lot of good feedback from people who found the talk interesting, so I wanted to record it for anyone else who would want to listen. So today I'm presenting grand rounds on social media and medicine, and before I begin, I have to thank my program director who's encouraged me every step of the way to pursue my research interests, as well as my institution for allowing me to present. You know, grand rounds is typically presented by an expert with years of experience in their field to offer updates in their field of expertise. So it is a really humbling honor to be recognized and be able to be giving this talk. But I'm sure what some of you and some of the people in real life when I gave this talk were wondering is, who am I and why should you be listening to me? And I hope that by showing people how I use social media as both an individual and as a medical professional, that I'll be able to get to the main objectives of this talk, examining the landscape of social media, comparing the risks and benefits of social media as a medical professional, and then some practical tips and tricks if you want to establish yourself as a social media professional. So before I jump into the presentation, I just have to acknowledge that if you hear any meowing, I promise it's not me, but we'll take it as it comes. So why should you be on social media? I think we all have to remember that as medical trainees, whether we're medical students, residents, fellows, or even continuing our education on as an attending, we're all here to learn for our patients' sake. And that's why I think that social media has a whole lot of different uses. And at the end of the day, each one of these uses of social media to learn, educate, publish and read research, advocate for your patients and legislation, to network with other professionals, or just use it as entertainment, are all pieces of career development. Social media is not going to replace any of these aspects of being a doctor or any type of health professional, but it can enhance your career development. And this slide from the Journal of the American College of Cardiology really epitomizes that. That social media isn't going to replace any of these specific things, but can certainly enhance them. Now, there are a whole lot of different ways that you can leverage social media to learn. And I think that you're probably already doing it. I don't think I've ever met a single medical student who didn't go to a lecture and then immediately try to find a YouTube video to learn what the professor was actually talking about. And I know during residency, I'm aging myself a little bit, but during residency, a lot of different medical podcasts started coming out as a unique way to learn on the go, whether you're at the gym or commuting. People are already using social media for their medical education. It's not just informal medical education, but it's also formal medical journals that are on social media. I often will use Twitter to follow a bunch of different medical journals like JACC or the Journal of the American College of Cardiology. As a cardiology fellow, that's kind of our Bible. And I remember distinctly just a month ago, I was on Twitter, found a tweet from JACC, and it was a really interesting article that I was able to read. And then a month later, I got the paper copy of JACC. So social media and Twitter allowed me to find some interesting articles in real time in a quicker manner than contemporary ways that journals are distributed. And it's not just cardiology journals that I use, but it's also... Sorry, my cat's being annoying. It is not just cardiology journals that I follow, but Twitter has also allowed me to follow a whole lot of other different specialties: internists, nephrologists, cardiothoracic surgeons, emergency medicine, and I've been able to read a whole lot of different journal articles that I would not have otherwise had access to or known existed, and that's all because I'm on social media. And it's not just journals, but also journal clubs. There are informal journal clubs on Twitter. The nephrology one is kind of the groundbreaking and most established one that I'm aware of that allows people to discuss a journal in a similar format to contemporary journal clubs, except you don't have to be in person. You can kind of do it on your own time. And if you're not able to live tweet and discuss with the experts in the field, you can then go back and just read what everyone was discussing. And I don't think in modern medical history we've ever been able to communicate directly with the author of the journal that you're discussing. So it also, social media has also given us the ability to communicate with experts around the world. And again, this is just showing you that social media or Twitter specifically has been used and is gaining more and more recognition in more established realms of medicine. it's not just journals, but also not journals. And what I mean by that is that there's a lot of bite-sized information that I learn on social media, be it Twitter, Instagram, by following different medical professionals in various fields that you wouldn't that wouldn't otherwise be publishable in a medical journal. Medical journals have a very high threshold for what they publish, and there's a lot of bite-sized information on social media, and it's things that remind me of rounds, of being in the hospital and seeing something small enough or unique enough that your attending gives you a nugget of knowledge about that you wouldn't have read about, but you learn in real time. And those are some of those unique things that we learn about on social media. And similarly, you're able to communicate with experts in your field from a variety of different specialties. One of the reasons why I love it, as I kind of alluded to already, is that you can explore outside of your specialty. I was preparing this slide and I saw this really awesome tweet by this physician who published a series of tweets with a really interesting CT scan. And if you take a look at the bottom left of the hand side, you can wonder, why is this 15-year-old boy with right lower quadrant pain have this really strange looking CT scan? And it ended up being Boba T, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. And what's fascinating to me is that, so this patient had appendicitis, and this was an incidental finding. But I never would have read about this in a medical journal. They're not gonna publish, ooh, look what Boba T looks like on CT scan. This patient didn't chew the tapioca, but they actually just swallowed it whole, and this is what it looks like. And I can imagine one day I might be in the hospital looking through a CT scan of my patient and go, what the hell is that? And I might be able to say, oh, that's probably boba tea. Let me go ask the patient if they've had any. And this patient, physician went on to discuss some of the aspects of boba tea and how some people are spreading some misinformation about boba tea that it could cause appendicitis, but this just happened to be an incidental finding. It wasn't the culprit of the patient's appendicitis. It's not just about learning about learning from medical professionals outside of your field, but you can even learn from subspecialists within your field. This was an interventional cardiologist who, again, taught a bite-sized piece of information that I might be able to use in real time. In cardiology, for our fellowship, we rotate through each aspect of cardiology, and one of those pieces is the interventional cardiology cath lab. And I can imagine what this learning point was. On the left-hand side, you can see a left heart catheterization of the coronary arteries, and you can see a focal area of stenosis. And this can happen. What basically happens is that the artery can spasm. It's not a heart attack in the contemporary sense of the word, where you have a plaque rupture causing a complete occlusion of a coronary artery, but the artery can spasm. And his learning point was that often what we do in the cath lab is we'll give some vasodilators to try to counteract the spasm and kind of diagnose and prove that it was spasm. And he was saying that you might need a higher dose if it doesn't work the first time. And that's simply another bite-sized piece of information that I might be able to actually use in my practice as a cardiology fellow. It's not just about communicating with experts outside of your field and in other areas of the world, but you can even use social media to communicate with experts at your own institution. WhatsApp was actually used in a really fascinating way by the Duke Cardiology Fellowship Program. They essentially created a WhatsApp group chat, as you can see on the right-hand side, and they would use those bite-sized pieces of information that attendings, fellows, anyone who had a unique piece of information that you might otherwise not be able to read about or that you might not be able to learn unless you're right there on rounds. And we use, and because cardiology is such a visual field, we're able to take a picture and discuss it in a group chat with formal guidelines on how to communicate with one another. And to hammer home the point that social media research is gaining more and more traction, this was even published in the Journal of American College of Cardiology Fellows in Training portion of the journal. I won't go into too much detail, but Twitter is already and has been established as one of the oldest uses of social media in medicine. We've used it traditionally to communicate with other professionals at national and international conferences to share our bite-sized information with other people who aren't able to be there at the conference. You can tag the conference, for instance, using hashtag ACC 2020 or hashtag chest for whatever meeting or conference you're at, and you can connect with other professionals who have other interests in your field. And you can also use social media to educate, as we've kind of gone over, other medical professionals, but also patients and colleagues. One of my favorite cardiologists on social media is Your Heart Doc, or Ali Hader. And one of the things that he does is he has a lot of saved slides or images of a TAVR, a transcatheter aortic valve replacement. And I will literally routinely pull up his Instagram while I'm with a patient, or when I'm with educating medical students, resident, or other residents. And if we're discussing aortic valve replacements, I'll literally pull this up. This isn't a video because it's a little bit difficult to show it on slides. But this is a screenshot of how we actually, a screenshot of the video showing a transcatheter aortic valve replacement. On the first slide, showing that big old sheath going up the aorta, and then it goes around the aortic arch, and then eventually we blow up the balloon and pace the heart at a very fast heart rate so it kind of stops moving so we can do what we need to do in a safe manner, and then we blow it up with a balloon. Never before have I been able to explain so visually to a patient what we're about to do. And the reason why I love doing that is because aortic valve replacements used to be open heart surgery, and now it's kind of looked at as quote unquote routine. I remember a patient of mine was kind of complaining about the food in the hospital, and that's always a good sign. And it was, we kind of had a great conversation about how the fact is that this is the procedure that we're now able to do to replace an aortic valve, whereas 10, 15, 20 years ago, it would have been open heart surgery. I've also been able to use social media personally to promote public awareness and kind of advocate. I personally made a post about Be the Match bone marrow registry, and it was a simple post that had a lot of impact. One of my best friends, his father had leukemia, and every year he promotes the Be the Match bone marrow registry, and I wanted to kind of piggyback on that and do something good to show that you don't need to be a doctor to save a life. And my ethos is always with patients or on social media that if you can impact or improve the life or answer the question of one person, that, you know, that post is worth the effort. And I remember getting, you know, three or four messages from people saying that they signed up for the Be the Match. And even after I gave my grandgrand's presentation, one of my co-fellows messaged me saying that he was motivated to do that. And it just goes to show you that you can really make a big impact in multiple different ways. During the COVID-19 pandemic, I teamed up with a bunch of other prominent cardiologists on social media to remind our patients that just because it is the COVID pandemic, that people can still have heart attacks. You still need to seek care for your issues. We notice a trend that there were fewer and fewer people having heart attacks during the COVID-19 pandemic, and there are a lot of different hypotheses about why that's happening. Maybe people are less active and there's less plaque rupture, but all in all, part of it might be that people are simply not seeking care. And as you can see, I got kind of stuck with holding the heart on the bottom right-hand screen. But we wanted to remind patients and advocate for them that they need to seek cardiac care if they need to, even during a pandemic, and that it was safe to do so. Individual physicians are not the only people that are doing this. Formal organizations like the CDC and WHO did this during the Zika virus epidemic, as well as back in the day for the Ebola epidemic. And they were able to give out bite-sized information. And these are slides that were published on the CDC website for people to share. So it's not just individuals who are using social media to benefit the general public and our patients, but it's also formal large institutions. This was also a infographic that I found on Twitter about the COVID-19 pandemic. I won't go into all the different details, but one of the amazing things about the COVID pandemic and social media is that never before in human history have we been able to collectively, as a world, fight one disease together and be able to share valuable information that could save lives. There was one New Zealand, I believe it was a New Zealand hospital, that produced a infographic for anesthesiologists in order to that was a protocol for anesthesiologists to intubate patients safely for both the patient as well as to prevent spread of COVID to those performing the intubation. And that simple act of sharing their information on social media by established individuals allowed other institutions to not have to repeat that same process and save them time, and allowed us to potentially save the lives of other physicians and patients. Additionally, during the COVID pandemic, there were doctors, nurses, individuals who were healthcare professionals who got COVID, who were live tweeting their disease process, how they felt. And it's just amazing to think that we live in a day and age where that's even possible. Now, it's not just medical professionals that are on social media. Our patients are on there too. I love you, Mom, and I know that they'll be one of the first people to watch this video. But that's the point of this slide, is that our patients are on social media and they are getting healthcare information on social media. I use this slide to illustrate that back in the day, information used to spread pretty slowly. People had to literally copy stuff by hand. And then the printing press revolutionized things. And the internet has accelerated the spread of information and also misinformation infinitefold. Now, the reason I bring this up is because in 2005, a study found that 90% of adults 50 years of age or older are using Facebook to find and share healthcare information. So whether we like it or not, people are using social media to find healthcare information. And that's not always a good thing, because the people who are giving out advice are not always qualified to do so. An analysis of Instagram showed only 5% of top dermatology-related posts were created by board-certified dermatologists. Now, there are a lot of qualified healthcare professionals, PAs, NPs, nurses, individuals who have chronic diseases of chronic dermatological diseases who might be valuable information individuals to hear. Sorry, that's pepperoni over there. There are a lot of individuals who might be able to offer good insight into dermatology and other healthcare related posts, but it just goes to show you that a lot of the information the general public are consuming are not curated by individuals who have the authority to be giving advice on that topic. And that's kind of the crux of it, is that physicians and healthcare professionals might also be on social media, but most of the posts are by people who kind of have an inverse relationship between the number of followers they have and the expertise and the credentials that they don't have to be giving that advice. So I've kind of gone through understanding the landscape of social media, and hopefully we'll be able to kind of piggyback on that and go into the risks and benefits of social media as a medical professional. A lot of these things will blur a little bit as we keep going. So the dangers of social media as a healthcare professional, aka how not to get fired. And this is not specific to my institution. These are tips and tricks that you should know about for the rest of your career. So I use this example from a great nurse practitioner who's on social media, who many years ago posted this picture, as you can see based on the phone and the format of Instagram. And it was actually a repost, and it was man versus six train dot 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 the after and a bunch of hashtags. And it was a trauma bay after a trauma victim came to the emergency department. Pepperoni is also very distraught by this. Now, just think to yourself, do you have any immediate concerns about this image? Are you concerned about it? I mean, the section of my talk is dangers of social media, so you can assume that there's something negative that's gonna happen. But think about if you were a family member and you went to that hospital, let's say the hospital was tagged in the photo. What if it was a very specific incident where there was only one six train and only one individual who got hurt and you knew that person? It's a small world, and social media can make it even smaller. Now, unfortunately, this nurse was fired for quote unquote posting a photo that someone could find offensive. But that's the reality of being a healthcare professional on social media. You have to be very careful about what you post. And the first thing that I always tell people to do is read your employer's social media policy. Again, this isn't specific to my institution. This is something that you need to do for the rest of your career. And many social media policies from healthcare networks are kind of vague, and they basically say be professional, because it's hard to describe everything that you can't post, but you kind of know unprofessional posts on social media when you see it. And just because you don't say the patient's name and date of birth doesn't mean that you're not breaking HIPAA. Let's say you are admitting a patient with an extremely rare disease and there's only 5 cases every 10 years. If you post about it in real time, patients again can connect the dots and you can end up breaking HIPAA unintentionally. So the other piece of advice that I always tell people is to never post in real time. Again, if this picture were to have been taken and then posted years later, maybe that would have been more okay, but it's also to prevent a violation of HIPAA and keep yourself safe. Another case that is not so fictional, let's say you post a story on Instagram and it just says, so tired after a 28-hour shift, one more surgery to go, and then you tag your workplace. First thing I always tell people is never tag your workplace. There's nothing to benefit by tagging your workplace or where you're at. It is not a good thing if a patient or their family are at the hospital and they go to that hospital's social media page and they were to see this. I mean, what are some of the concerns that you can think about? I mean, right off the top of the bat, I want to know why my cat is performing surgery, and if any animal is going to be performing surgery, I don't know if I'd want it to be a cat. But more seriously, you have to be cautious about tagging your workplace. And imagine, what if a family member saw this? How would you feel if your mom, dad, sibling, aunt, anyone was going into surgery and you saw them post right before we go in that they were up for 28 hours on call? Now, it's just not something that you want to see. On top of that, even if you're joking, even if this is blunt sarcasm, that can be really hard to interpret and hear over the internet. So you have to be careful, even if you're being sarcastic. So those are the 5 tips that I think everyone can start doing right now when you are using social media as a medical professional. So we went through the landscape of social media, some of the risks and benefits of social media as a medical professional. Let's go into some other practical tips and tricks of using social media as a medical professional and how to establish yourself. Now, let's say you're thinking about starting a social media professional account. It can be overwhelming. I know one of my favorite attendings, he works in heart failure, and I always tell him that every single time we talk after rounds about a certain topic, I just want to record that information and put it into a podcast. And I understand the limitations of people. No one has extra time in their day to start a podcast. And there is a steep learning curve. But I think at the end of the day, if I could get anyone to join, it's because everyone has something to offer. Whatever stage of training you're at, there are people who look up to you, and there's nuggets of knowledge that you can share to help enhance the education of other people. So why am I on social media? Hopefully this will show you how I use it. This isn't the right way. This is how I do it. So I started out on social media back in my med school days. I went to Ross University on the Caribbean island of Dominica. And the way that Ross University works is that every semester, there's another semester that comes after you. So when I was a second semester, there was another first semester class right behind me. When I was a third semester, there's another first semester class right behind me. So on and so forth. And what I found is every single year, the med students change, but the questions stay the same. And that is true in residency, fellowship, and I'm sure attendings get the same questions. And it's likely true in other fields of medicine, whether you're a respiratory therapist, occupational therapist, physical therapist, registered dietitian, any of the other medical professionals, PAs, NPs, nurses. Everyone wants to know the same questions. How do you succeed in this school? How do you study for it? How do you succeed in residency? How do you pass your step exams, all those basic pieces of information. And I wanted to create a trusted resource so that, I mean, first off, I could stop repeating myself, but more so that I can give someone advice and then they can also have a reference that I can send them for more information. And not only that, but it's the classic example of if one person raises their hand and asks a question in a classroom, there's probably 10 other people thinking it. So I wanted to create a platform, and that's why I created my blog, to allow not just Caribbean Med students at my school, but possibly other schools or around the world to offer that same pieces of information. And that's what I've tried to continue to do in residency and fellowship, is uncovering the hidden curriculum of med school. I've tried to answer simple questions that every med student and resident has every single year. Things like how to write your personal statement, how to apply to residency, what happens if you don't match into residency, what happens if you don't match into residency twice. These were great interviews with someone, a physician who's now matched into family medicine in Florida, who was courageous enough to allow me to interview them and give us a glimpse into what do you do if you don't match, because it's something that we often don't talk about. Other tips and blog posts that I've written, step exams and resources and how I study for them, and also how interviews with individuals on how to match into various fellowships like hem-onc and gastroenterology. While I've been in fellowship, I've tried to shift more towards patients, and that's always been my long-term goal. I know that I initially started out as on my blog being more of an authority on how to succeed in medical school, because that's what I felt comfortable writing about. I didn't feel like I could write about how to take your meds or advice to specifically to patients. Whereas in fellowship, I've been able to focus both on cardiology and on patient care. So one of the things that I've enjoyed doing is every single topic that I end up finding that I repeat myself every single time if someone rotates through cardiology, I'll try to make a blog post and Instagram post about it. So one of those things, if anyone's ever rotated with me, is we'll often learn about telemetry. It's one of those things that you have to learn on the job. There's no textbook that you can read about tele in order to show you how to do it. And I think we've all been there when an attending says, did you check tele? And you kind of meekly like look at them and go like, I mean, yeah, I checked tele. I don't know what it showed, but I looked at it. So I often have a typical spiel of how to go through telemetry, but then I'll also send those residents and med students who I work with a blog post going into further detail and further little tidbits that I've seen in my clinical practice, so that they can compound their knowledge and really secure that understanding of how to use telemetry on the inpatient wards. And I've tried to create blog posts that are both educational for medical students as well as patients. One of the things that people are often confused about is how do cardiologists evaluate palpitations and the tools that we use. What is a 48-hour Holter? What's an extended Holter or a Zio patch? What do you mean by an implantable loop recorder? So this is a blog post that I made to help explain to med students the different tools, benefits of each one, duration of use, and why you might want to use each one. And something that's also at the level of patients, so we can explain to them, oh, after the discharge, you're going to follow up with electrophysiology and get a possible Zio patch. This is some more information. Now, I know we can always send the patient an up-to-date article, but I find it more effective and more personable to be able to tell them to send them a curated article by their doctor and by someone who they've established a relationship and trust. On top of that, I found that one of the platforms I enjoy using more is YouTube. Case in point, this presentation. But I found that I'm better able to communicate on a longer platform video format. And I've been able to create two of my favorite YouTube videos for patient care. On the left-hand side is Medications After a Heart Attack. It was an educational video that's available for you guys if you wanna check them out, about dual antiplatelet therapy after a heart attack. And on the right-hand side, I created that video actually for my mom. She told me that her doctor, she's fine, that her doctor told her to start checking her blood pressure at home. And I found that I ended up giving her kind of the similar advice that I give to my patients. So for my YouTube video for blood pressure, funnily enough, the very next day when I was in clinic, I found that I was talking to my patients again about how to take their blood pressure at home. And I could see the kind of glazed eyes over where they got most of the information, but I felt kind of like he was what I experience when I go to the mechanic. You know, my car light went on and I told my dad about it. He told me, go to the car dealership, they'll fix it. And he asked me, what did they do? And I said, I don't know, I took the car in, they fixed something, and now the light's off, and then they took some of my money. So it's, I don't know, it's fixed. And I feel like I empathize with the patients who come into the hospital after a heart attack. They might only be on one or two meds or no meds at all. And then they leave the hospital on five or six new medications. Or the patients who come to the emergency department and with chest pain, and they end up talking to their family members, and they're asked, you know, what do they do? And they go, I don't know. They said I had chest pain, and then they took some blood and told me to run on a treadmill at a doctor's office or something. It can be a lot of information. And I wanted to create a video that I could share with my patient so that they can reference it in the future and look back at the conversation that we had, and also to be able to share that with their family members so that everyone involved can better understand the care that they're receiving. And for those who are more research oriented, I've even been able to have on the left-hand side that video be an educational resource, and we turned it into a quality improvement project where we had 50 patients who had a heart attack and had a stent placed and were placed on dual antiplatelet therapy. And we found that these patients actually, compared to our control group, had a slightly better compliance rate long-term. So you can even turn these sort uses of social media into actual publishable research. So all in all, why I'm on social media as a medical professional, I like to uncover the hidden curriculum of those who come after me. I want to curate a library of reliable and accurate information for my patients, and also share life outside of medicine. You know, cardiology, life outside of medicine, and my, oh no, that's not, that wasn't supposed to be, I'm sorry, more of my cat. I'm just kidding. But if you do see my social media, it is a good amount of my cat Pepperoni, but it's also about the medical trainees who come after me. On top of that, the other three things that I've really enjoyed about being on social media as a medical professional is learning and educating, as I've kind of gone through. I've also had the opportunity to meet amazing people in Philly and across the country, online and in real life, who I otherwise wouldn't have had the opportunity to. And it's also been a source of a small amount of supplemental income. So ultimately, social media is what you make of it. There are some amazing accounts at the style prescription on the left-hand side and at bedside rounds on the right-hand side. On the left, he shares a whole lot of pediatric information, some style tips, and awesome clothing styles. And he's also started to foray into memes, and they are hilarious. And on the right-hand side, bedside rounds, talking about the vaccine. It still cracks me up. But he's also been able to use memes to educate, to actually educate people about the about the meaningful use of normal saline and other real life medical tips and tricks. So you can use social media how you want and make it how you want to use it. So again, I kind of alluded to this before I jumped into how I use social media. There is a steep learning curve. And I just love this meme from Mad Men. And to me, it kind of does epitomize what it feels like when you start a new technology or a new platform. And I look at this kind of similar to my parents, that I'm super proud of them that they don't have to call me to find the TV video button anymore. Mostly because I act confused and I got them to call my brother, half joking. But more so that they are great at using iPhones, using new technology, because they've kept up to date with it and they're pretty darn good at that stuff. So I think that everyone is capable of learning how to use social media. It's just taking that effort and taking that next step. And it's not just using new technology, but some, again, trying to target my attending to try to get to convince him to start a podcast. I know that people don't have a lot of extra time on their hands, but every time that you give a lecture as an attending, think about what if you could give the residents or medical students, anyone who you're giving a lecture to, a copy of it so that they can go back and look at it on their own time. And I'm not just trying to throw shade at attendings. I recently got on TikTok and it took me a good amount of time to figure out how I want to use it. But before I started creating any content. So if you're interested in starting a social media presence, you all have a lot to offer. And I think that it can be a little overwhelming to figure out what you're going to do. So I think one of the best pieces of advice I got was to pick three major themes you want to focus on. Again, I've kind of gone over mine is helping trainees, cardiology, and life outside of medicine. And you just want to try to find your three major themes and things that you want to talk about, whether it's patient education, your life as a minority in medicine, your life as a respiratory therapist, or maybe you just want to be a meme page and educate people. Whatever it is, try to pick three different things that you want to kind of focus on that you would be excited to share with people on social media. The other thing that's really overwhelming is that there's a whole lot of platforms and there's new ones all the time coming out, and you just got to figure out what works for you. A little bit of exploring the space. I know that, again, I use Instagram to share a lot of pictures and short media posts with some written information. And I lurk mostly on Twitter. I'm not very active, but I use it to kind of read a whole lot of different medical information. And I enjoy using YouTube as a platform to educate patients and others and students and trainees, as I've gone over. But there's certainly other ones, and you don't need to be on all of them. It took me a long time to finally give in and join TikTok. And the main reason is I knew TikTok was going to be big, but I just didn't have the energy at the time when I discovered TikTok to jump on it. I knew that getting on another social media platform wasn't going to be a good thing for my mental health, so I didn't do it. But now I found that I do enjoy it and it does have its valuable uses. But there's still more platforms. I would love to have a podcast, but I don't have the time to focus on it. And frankly, that's the other aspect of it, is that of social media use for trainees mostly, is that you should never have your time on social media replace your time where you're learning to be a doctor. That's our number one goal here in residency training. But you can also use social media to educate others, because I've always said, if you can teach someone a topic, then you really know it. So if you want to use your social media posts as a way to kind of test yourself and educate others, that's another great use for it. But you don't need to be on all of them. In fact, another one just popped up this month, Clubhouse. I just haven't jumped on it because I don't want to. And that's perfectly okay. Other thing, maybe for trainees, less so for some attendings, is focus on creating high quality content. Don't chase followers and likes. If you have 10,000 followers, but only 10 people ever interact with your content and find it information, I find that to be less powerful than if you have 100 followers and each one of them are dedicated people who enjoy your content and find it useful. If you have high quality content and you find your own little niche, all of the followers and likes will follow. Ha, no pun intended. Other aspects that people don't really talk about, and one of the reasons why I was excited to give this talk is about business ethics and white coat marketing. I think in medical training, unfortunately, because most social media policies for institutions and medical schools is don't be on social media and don't do anything unprofessional, we are not educating our residents and medical trainees properly. Simple questions like, what if a patient messages you on Facebook? What do you do? Things that are more applicable to the real world. And I think that if we don't train our students and residents and also attendings on how to meaningfully, ethically, and properly use social media, then we are failing our patients too. So, what do I mean by business ethics and white coat marketing? Essentially, you have to carry through your same medical ethics that you do in person online. My first slide is my first point was that your time isn't free. It isn't. And it's perfectly okay to ask for financial reimbursement if you're going to be promoting something or taking the time out of your day to create a specific post. But you are worth more to companies than the companies are worth to you. Meaning that you took decades, potentially, to earn your degree. It is far more valuable for a company to see a doctor holding their product than what you get out of it. So you have to be careful about what you promote. I know that I just recently turned down a blood pressure cuff because it just felt kind of gross. I've had tons of supplement companies and CBD companies reach out to me, offering me a good amount of money to promote their product. But I would never do that for a patient, so I shouldn't do that online. And then the last part of it is the passive medical endorsement. If you stand with a white coat and stethoscope and take a vitamin and say, I love this vitamin, you're giving a passive endorsement that as a medical professional, I recommend this product. Individuals have literally lost their residency slots because of this. So whenever you're on social media, just wonder, is this really worth it if you're teaming up with a company? One of those last questions that I don't have a specific answer to, I only know what I do, is do you do a separate professional and personal account? On Instagram, I don't have the energy to post to do that. I don't really care enough. And the reason I say that is because I don't post that much on social media for my own personal gain all that much. So I find that if I can post things on social media that is appropriate for if my parents, friends, family, or boss and colleagues or patients see on social media, that's kind of the general ethos that I follow. However, each platform's a little bit different. For instance, Facebook, it might be easier to simply have a separate professional account, and many medical professionals do. And you really have to think about this long and hard for yourself and figure out what works for you. So again, if you're thinking about starting a social media presence, these are some easy tips and tricks. But the last thing that I'll say is just have fun. If it turns into work, if you're just not enjoying yourself on the platforms, take a break. Social media is not the crux of medicine. It should be a byproduct of you advancing and learning as a medical trainee. The last point that I'll have is that the Association of Healthcare Social Media is a great organization that focuses on a lot of these different topics. In fact, they have a YouTube tutorial on how to effectively use YouTube as a medical professional later this week. And it's a great organization if you're interested in learning more about this type of information. And thank you for listening.